You mentioned that we're constantly constructing our memories. Are we constantly in control of that? Is it us that's constructing the memory? Now, some of this has to do with control, like free will. Is this just automatically happening? Do we have some degree of autonomy or degree of direction that we can place on it?
So doing a, like, proper discussion of free will can take, you know, an infinite amount of time. But just to say something relevant is two things. One is, I think a useful sense of free will is very time extended. You don't have right now complete control of whatever your next thought is going to be. And in fact, you know, as you think about free from what? Free from past experience? No. And you don't want to be free from past experience because then you don't learn. You know, free from the laws of physics? No. So what do you really have at the moment, like within a narrow time frame? Maybe not much. But over the long term, by the application of consistent effort, what you can do is shape your own cognitive structure so that in the future, new things are open to you. Your own structure allows you to do new things. So I think free will exists in the time extended sense, where what the one thing you have free will over is consistent effort to modify yourself and your environment so that future you is more in line with whatever your values are than otherwise it would be. That's what you have. You have the ability to apply consistent effort. I think about it almost like calculus. You know, in the limit, it's infinitesimally small, but eventually you end up with something, right? And that's what I think it is. You know, the actual, at any given moment, it's like infinitesimally small amount of free will. But if you keep showing up and keep at it, you will shape yourself and the information you have and the world you live in, whatever, in a way that is more in accordance to your values. That I think is a useful form of free will. The other thing to point out, and this is kind of a really weird kind of direction that I've been going in lately, is that there are actually two ways of thinking about this. One way of thinking about this is as the being that is interpreting memories. And so this gets into a whole thing of who's the machine and who's the data. So we have this standard kind of Turing paradigm where it's like, okay, this is the physical organism, or the machine. This thing takes actions, and then there's passive data, and it sort of processes the data, maybe interprets it, maybe stores it, maybe generalizes it to form a, you know, some sort of an n-gram or something. But I actually think, for reasons that we could talk about, that the patterns themselves and perhaps the memories themselves have agency of their own. And this is, William James kind of nodded at this when he said the thoughts are thinkers, right? This distinction, this fundamental, people tend to make a very fundamental distinction. I'm a real physical object, and then I have patterns of activity in my excitable medium that are thoughts. It's I think it's much deeper than that. And I think what we could ask is, the agent is interpreting those memories, but some of those memories as patterns, as we are metabolic patterns ourselves, have some amount of agency to alter the way that they get processed. So I realize this is like a very strange idea, but I actually think the memories are not passive data. And you can warm up to this a little. There's a couple of ways to warm up to it. One is to think about, look, here's a continuum, a fleeting thought, right? There's a mental pattern that comes and goes. It's gone. Not much agency there. Well, then you get some persistent and repetitive thoughts. Those are harder to get rid of, and they do something interesting. They do a little, and you may have more to say on this than I, they do a little bit of niche construction on the brain. If you have certain kinds of thoughts, they will actually modify your brain such that you will have more of those thoughts, right? So ecologists would say that's niche construction. Then we could go past that, and we can think about something like a personality fragment or an alter, right? Not a full human personality, but also not just a repetitive thought. It's got a little bit of, you know, it has some goal directedness. It will actually do stuff in the world to sometimes screw stuff up for some of the other personalities. Like, it really has some agent. And then you have a full human personality, and maybe past that some sort of a transpersonal thing that people have talked about. So we can easily see how there's a continuum here. And I think that some of these thoughts, and you can imagine as patterns within a cognitive medium, think like an easier way to think about this is the caterpillar to butterfly transition, right? So you have a caterpillar. It's a soft-bodied creature with a particular controller, right? Soft body means you can't push. There are no hard elements to push on like you would with a robot. With a hard-bodied robot, you have to do different things. And it lives in basically a two-dimensional world. It crawls around and it eats leaves. You can and this is some old work by Doug Blackiston and a number of other people, you can train those caterpillars to, there's a certain color cue, and then they crawl over and they find some leaves and, you know, they're happy. That caterpillar has to become a butterfly. In order to become a butterfly, that's a hard-bodied creature that lives in a three-dimensional world. The brain is completely different. So it has to tear down most of the brain. Most of the cells die. Most of the connections are broken. And you make a new brain, you make a butterfly. The memories persist. Now, that's amazing enough because you're like, wow, how do memories persist when you're refactoring the whole medium? But it's actually much more interesting than that. And it took me years to actually get to what's really interesting about this, which is that the actual memories, like the fidelity of the memory is actually not what you need here at all, because the actual memories of the caterpillar are useless to the butterfly. It doesn't move the same way. It doesn't care about leaves. None of the details matter. The details are completely irrelevant. But what you do inherit as a butterfly are kind of the deep lessons that the caterpillar learn. And so you have to not only keep the information, you have to remap and reinterpret that. Whatever engrams survive the brain, you know, refactoring, those engrams cannot be used the way the caterpillar used them. You have to reinterpret them in a completely new way, remap them onto a new sensory motor architecture and everything else. So one could imagine that if there's that process, if a particular memory as an agent wants to survive that process, you cannot stay the same. It's the same paradox that affects us all. If you don't change, you will die. If you do change, you're no longer yourself. So you're also not here, right? Like it applies to species. It applies to everything. It's the paradox of change. If you are a memory that wants to survive that process, you cannot remain exactly how you are. But you might have certain features that would make you more easily interpretable by the butterfly brain, and thus you will make it into this new world, not the same as you were, but to some extent you will remain, right? So I think there's two things going on in this process that you asked about. One is the agent is shuffling and reinterpreting these memories, and our current model of this is like this bow tie model that you see in, for example, in autoencoders and neural cellular automata and things like this, where the process of learning compresses into a generative seed, into an engram, that thin middle layer of that architecture, and so that's an algorithmic process, right? You generalize instances into a rule. But then the other right side of that bow tie, the expansion side, that's creative. That's not algorithmic, because you've lost information. You've lost all the you've squeezed out a lot of the correlations, and now you're going to interpret what those memories mean. And this is what I meant earlier when I said that, you know, a key thing of a self is to figure out what your own memories mean, because you don't know, right? You are not tied to using them. And you know, what you were saying about this makes you fit. This is the thing that makes me happy, is this idea that you are in no way tied to the story that was told by your past self, even as far back as whatever, 300 milliseconds. You are always in the job of reinterpreting, and you can always tell a better story. And the way that your past self was compressing and interpreting that information, you are now free to tell it differently. And this is also, one last thing. This is also what happens in embryonic development with the genome, because every embryo, they look very reliable, and it looks like all they're doing is interpreting like they're following the same cues that their ancestors did all back in the, you know, in the lineage. So interestingly enough, that same information dynamic is true not only for cognitive systems within their lifetime, but actually for embryogenesis and for evolution as a whole, because we might think that embryogenesis is stereotypical, that basically every embryo just follows the same rules that the past lineage has. But what we see and that's what normally happens under normal circumstances. But when you start investigating that cognitive system by putting barriers between it and its goal, meaning trying to deflect it from the thing it's trying to build, you find out that no, it actually has incredible creative problem-solving capacity. It doesn't take the meaning of that genome literally at all. It takes the molecular mechanisms that are encoded by that genome as affordances, which it can reshuffle in new ways. And this is, there are some amazing, I've talked about this before, but some amazing ways that embryos and other morphogenetic systems manage to make a new thing under a new environment in circumstances where all of its parts have changed, like massive change. They can still figure out how to get the job done, by not doing it exactly the way their ancestors did, but by creatively finding a new solution in this problem space. So I think there are two aspects to this. One is that creative interpretation of what your memories, whether they be the genetic memories of your lineage or the actual behavioral memories of a mind, what do your memories mean? And then there's the other question of, okay, but you are a metabolic pattern. You're a ship of Theseus that exists in various other spaces. These memories are other kinds of patterns. Some of them have some degree of agency as well, anywhere along that spectrum that we talked about. And what are their goals? Are their goals to proliferate through as many minds as possible? Is it to persist? Is it to grow? Is it to change? I have no idea. But I think we need to be looking at it from both perspectives, because it is not obvious who's the agent and who's the data. That's our framing, like you said before. That's a framing that we bring. And how you map that onto reality is there are multiple ways of doing that.
Well, that's interesting and inspirational. Let me roughly state back what you said. There are tools that are given to us, and there are the ways that our ancestors have used those tools, and I'll call that the literal way. We don't have to use those tools in the literal way because we have a goal. We can creatively use those tools, and in fact, cells do that as well. They don't literally look at the genome. They have a goal, and they can change. There's some wiggle room. Now, you're extending that further into memory, that we don't have to look at the way that we have interpreted memory in the past. We can think about what is our goal now and then change our interpretation to serve us moving forward.
Yeah. Basically, because biology, both the kind that gives rise to our bodies and by extension, what gives rise to our minds, is committed to the idea that you don't know what your substrate meant to anybody, including your past self, because it is labile. But the biological substrate is unreliable. This is one difference between us and our current computer architectures, where you work like hell to make sure that all the data at every level stays exactly how you put it, right? You don't, you know, when you're programming in a high level language, you don't think that your registers are going to float off because the copper gets warm. Like, the whole point of a good computer is that that does not happen. In biology, it's exactly the opposite. Biology commits from the beginning. The material is unreliable. We don't know how many copies of anything we're going to have. We don't know if our parts are going to be the same. In fact, you know they're not. They will mutate over time. So all we're committed to is telling the best story we can right now. And that's why I think all life is fundamentally a sense-making process. It's a storytelling agent, basically. And you don't know what your information meant to anything in the past. All you're going to do is make the best story of it you can now. And those differences may be small for a human. Unlike a caterpillar, you know, your brain mostly doesn't change that much. So the story doesn't float that much, but it can significantly. And I'm sure you can talk about therapeutic situations where it changes massively, you know?
As you know, on Theories of Everything, we delve into some of the most reality-spiraling concepts, from theoretical physics and consciousness to AI and emerging technologies. To stay informed in an ever-evolving landscape, I see The Economist as a wellspring of insightful analysis and in-depth reporting on the various topics we explore here and beyond. The Economist's commitment to rigorous journalism means you get a clear picture of the world's most significant developments, whether it's in scientific innovation or the shifting tectonic plates of global politics. The Economist provides comprehensive coverage that goes beyond the headlines. What sets The Economist apart is their ability to make complex issues accessible and engaging, much like we strive to do in this podcast. If you're passionate about expanding your knowledge and gaining a deeper understanding of the forces that shape our world, then I highly recommend subscribing to The Economist. It's an investment into intellectual growth, one that you won't regret. As a listener of Toe, you get a special 20% off discount. Now you can enjoy The Economist and all it has to offer for less. Head over to their website, www.economist.com/toe, T-O-E, to get started. Thanks for tuning in. And now back to our explorations of the mysteries of the universe.